past, present, and future. Conspiracy, one of the darkest words in human history. British Chancellor Reginald McKenna was also chairman of the Midland Bank in London. In 1924, he said,
I am afraid that ordinary citizens will not like to be told that the banks can and do create and destroy money, and they who control the credit of the nation direct the policy of governments and hold in the hollow of their hands the destiny of the people.
For the past 300 years, men of different nationalities and many religious and non-religious backgrounds have joined forces and gained control over the world's money systems. They have established a superstructure of hidden power. These super-rich families are known as the international bankers. The key to their success has been to control and manipulate the money system of a nation while letting it appear to be controlled by the government. The net effect is to create money out of nothing, lend it to the government, and then collect interest on it. A rather profitable transaction, to say the least. Encyclopedia Britannica, 14th edition.
Banks create credit. It is a mistake to suppose that bank credit is created to any extent by the payment of money into the banks. A loan made by a bank is a clear addition to the amount of money in the community.
Lord Acton, Lord Chief Justice of England, in 1875 said,
the issue which has swept down the centuries and which will have to be fought sooner or later is the people versus the banks.
Dr. Coombs was Governor of the Australian Reserve Bank and financial advisor to every Prime Minister, Liberal and Labor, for nearly 30 years. In a speech at Queensland University in 1954, he said,
any given piece of expenditure can be financed from one of four sources, or a combination of these sources. New savings, accumulated reserves, money borrowed other than a bank, money borrowed from a bank. The last source differs from the first three because when money is lent by a bank, it passes into the hands of the person who borrows it without anybody having less. Whenever a bank lends money, there is therefore an increase in the total amount of money available.
October 78, Review, a monthly magazine from the Bank of New South Wales, makes it quite clear that banks create money.
For example, if a bank wishes to purchase a government bond in the market, it makes payment for it by crediting the seller's bank, thus increasing total bank deposits. The largest proportion of bank assets is in overdrafts and loans. When a banker grants a customer credit by overdraft, the bank opens an account in its books and gives the client the right to draw funds without first having to put money into the account. But bank deposits only increase when the customer actually draws on the account to pay his creditors.
In Australia, we have an institution known as the Reserve Bank, which began as a semi-government operation. Here is a quote from its own publication.
The Reserve Bank has been banker to the Australian government since 1913. It is also banker to most of the state governments and a few large government instrumentalities.
Most of the money spent by the government is borrowed from the Reserve Bank, so the government debt is the initial loan plus interest. Some people still believe that the Reserve Bank is run by the government, but here again from the Reserve Bank's own publication.
The Reserve Bank Act came into operation on the 14th of January 1960, and from that date the bank has been a completely separated central bank with its own board, governor and staff.
The idea is to make it appear that the government controls the Reserve Bank, but in effect the Reserve Bank controls the government. Now how has this come about? The Magna Carta was one of the most magnificent documents ever written by man. Being based on the Bible, in essence it said,
you have the right to do as you wish, to succeed or to fail, whichever you choose, but you may not interfere with the rights of others to do the same.
Regarding money, it stated,
anyone who charges or receives interest will be put to death.
Obviously, this was not popular with certain money lenders. About 1690, King William was short of money as a result of a war with France. Despite the law, the money lenders demanded interest on a loan to the king. How could he pay it back? Increased taxes, of course. Does that sound familiar? The money lenders also forced him to pass a law allowing them to set up a bank with exclusive power to create money out of nothing. Through this conspiracy, England's entire money system fell into private hands. In 1694, William Paterson obtained the charter for the Bank of England. In a boastful mood, Paterson said,
the bank hath benefit of interest on all monies, which it creates out of nothing.
You might ask,
what's wrong with the banking system creating money?
For every $100 million they create out of nothing and lend to people and governments at, say, 10%, an additional $10 million is added to the debt every year. Where will the extra $10 million come from? Whatever your answer may be, the money for the interest does not exist. It will have to be created by a bank somewhere, and they will charge interest on that as well. The present structure of banking guarantees that every nation will always be in debt, and governments, good or bad, will be held to ransom by the bankers. Taxation in Australia in the early 1920s was only 2.5%. Today, direct and indirect taxation takes more than 50 cents out of every honest dollar that a person earns. And remember, this is to pay interest on money created out of nothing. Go into a modern bank and ask for a loan. You probably believe that the money or credit that you obtain is taken from other people's savings or fixed deposits. This is simply not true. Has your bank manager ever notified you that he has lent some of your money to someone else and now you have less money in the bank? Banks never lend the money they hold in deposits. All loans and overdrafts are new money created out of nothing at the stroke of a pen. They then charge interest on top. Very profitable. Banks offer interest on deposits as a smokescreen to disguise their operations. This book, None Dare Call It Conspiracy, is an excellent starting point for understanding the operations of the world's money power structure and how the international bankers have set up a conspiracy to create a one-world rulership. It was a conspiracy that directed Brutus against Caesar in the Roman Senate on the Ides of March. It was a conspiracy that organized the assassination of President Lincoln in 1865. History is full of accounts of assassinations, secret combines, palace plots, and betrayals over the centuries. Yet, despite this clear record, an amazing number of people scoff at the possibility of conspiracy. This segment is to show that the conspiratorial view of history, and especially recent history, is the correct view, and that there are secret and powerful combines at work today.
Power brokers in secret talks.
Each year, a top secret meeting known as the Bilderberg Conference is attended by the richest and most powerful men on earth. This group has produced the last three American presidents, the last three prime ministers of Britain, the president of France, and chancellor of West Germany. So let's see what this is all about. Bavaria, 1786. Acting on a tip from an informer, police raided the home of a prominent attorney named von Zwack. They seized documents and letters revealing that he was a high-ranking member of an extensive conspiracy called the Order of the Illuminati. Over the centuries, different forms of the word Illuminati, meaning the enlightened ones, have been used by many secret lodges and occult organizations. Most were primarily concerned with psychological and spiritual objectives, a proclaimed inner wisdom and mind mastery of the secrets of the universe. The conspiracy exposed in Bavaria, however, was entirely different. This Illuminati was founded by Adam Weishaupt on May 1st, 1776. He had been a student of the Jesuits, but he rebelled and started his own group in opposition. Weishaupt wanted to establish a world order. In his Illuminati, there are eight levels from the outermost novice inwards to Rex or King. The King, of course, was Weishaupt himself, who had adopted the code name Spartacus. Weishaupt's followers were merely puppets enticed into front organizations. Today, people with a sincere desire to improve the world are attracted to welfare schemes and world brotherhoods. But Weishaupt said,
"These good folks swell our numbers and fill our money box. Set yourselves to work. These gentlemen must be made to nibble at the bait, but this sort of people must always be made to believe that the grade they have reached is the last."
But by the time a member had reached the level of presbyter or priest, the oath of absolute secrecy had become deadly serious. Only then was he allowed to see the real goal. It was the destruction of Christianity and religion to be replaced by humanism, the worship of reason. They, the enlightened ones, must destroy all independent governments and usher in a new world order, a one world government. Some people call it the New Age. The Illuminati attracted many prominent men, both in government and finance, including the Rothschilds, who originally financed Adam Weishaupt. Some years later, an obscure intellectual named Karl Marx joined one of the front organizations, which was known as the League of the Just. It later changed its name to the Communist League. In 1847, Marx was hired to write their policy statement for the public. It was called the Communist Manifesto. On the surface, the manifesto appealed to the workers of the world to rise up against their so-called capitalist exploiters, but it should be noted that the project was financed by a wealthy man, Frederick Engels. Marx was considered so unimportant that his name didn't appear on the manifesto during the first 20 years of its publication. This information is available in old history books and encyclopedias. You won't find it in later editions where history has been rewritten. Here is a current edition. It's available in most left-wing bookshops. Karl Marx listed a 10-point program for taking over a nation.
abolition of property in land and application of all rents of land to public purposes.
That is, the government will own your home and you will pay rent.
A heavy progressive or graduated income tax.
That is, if you are productive, you will be victimised.
Abolition of all right of inheritance.
If you have worked and been careful, your savings will be confiscated by the government.
Confiscation of the property of all immigrants and rebels.
By Marx's definition, you are a rebel if you are opposed to compulsory socialism.
Centralisation of credit in the hands of the state.
So there you have it. Get control of the nation's money system. All nations have a central bank. We have the International Monetary Fund and a World Bank. All this has happened in the last few decades.
Centralisation of the means of communication and transport in the hands of the state.
We already have government railways, government shipping, Australia Post, telecom.
Extension of factories and instruments of production owned by the state. Equal liability of all to labour. Combination of agriculture with manufacturing industries.
Complete government control and ownership of all industry and production. You will have no say in who you work for, and certainly you won't be able to work for yourself.
Free education for all children in public schools.
Education is not free. Who pays for it? The government does, with your money. And government bureaucrats decide what your children will be taught. In many schools today, children are encouraged to study astrology and witchcraft under the guise of English lessons. Hard to believe? Get the tape on this subject.
60 years of communism and 100 million graves. Their discipline is to kill.
From 1831 to 1916, the so-called tyrannical czars executed only 997 people in 85 years. After the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917, almost 2 million people were murdered in the first 6 years of their so-called liberation, and that was just the beginning. After 60 years, over 100 million people have been murdered.
Despite the concrete, the barbed wire, the savage dogs and merciless guards, East Germans keep on coming. The dash for freedom has never been harder, but East Germans continue to risk being shot, blown up, electrocuted and savaged by dogs to escape to the West.
Why does this so-called workers' paradise need barbed wire and bullets? The International Committee for the Defence of Human Rights reveals at least 200 forced labour camps currently in the Soviet Union. In Hungary and Poland, many of these man-proof enclosures were formerly lion parks and zoos close to major cities. Half the world is already under compulsory socialism. Let's see what's happening elsewhere. In recent years, we have seen the growth of an organisation called the World Council of Churches. Courier Mail, August 78, describes how this organisation has raised money from churches and used it to aid terrorists around the world. Millions of people are financially supporting this organisation. How many would continue to do so if they understood its origin and purpose?
Churches confirm guerrilla support. The World Council of Churches says its controversial grants to guerrillas in southern Africa are justified.
Here are some of the grants they had made to revolutionary groups up to 1971. Today, revolution is a multi-million dollar business. Much of it is being financed by the World Council of Churches. Where does the money go that you put on the plate? Key figures behind the World Council of Churches include renegade ministers, lecturers trained in Moscow, sponsors of communist organisations and publications, and others with leanings towards atheistic socialism and a one-world government. The World Council of Churches claims to be Christian, yet many anti-Christian religions belong to it, even the Church of Satan. The World Council of Churches is an Illuminati front designed to water down Christianity and coerce people into a one-world religion. Another front organisation of the Illuminati is the American CFR, the Council on Foreign Relations. It is through this organisation and outwards through tax-exempt foundations, universities and government agencies that the Illuminati has dominated the United States for over 60 years. In Harper's Magazine, July 58, there was an article entitled School for Statesmen, written by CFR member Joseph Kraft. At the time of writing the article, Kraft boasted that the CFR membership included
the President, the Secretary of State, the Chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission, the Director of the CIA, the Board Chairman of three of the country's five largest industrial corporations, two of the four richest insurance companies, and two of the three biggest banks, plus the senior partners of two of the three leading Wall Street law firms, the publishers of the two biggest news magazines and of the country's most influential newspaper, and the presidents of the big three in both universities and foundations, as well as a score of other college presidents and a scattering of top scientists and journalists.
Here is a cabinet meeting when Johnson was president. We see the Postmaster General, Ministers of Agriculture, Labor, Health, Education, Welfare, people from the Treasury, and the United Nations Ambassador. Practically all the men here are CFR members. Most people have never heard of the CFR, yet it is the unseen government of the United States. This is an American $1 note. On the left is the symbol of the Illuminati. Apparently, it was taken by Adam Weishaupt from the occult symbolism of ancient history. This symbol is also used by the Freemasons, the Jesuits, the Rosicrucians, and similar organizations. It looks rather unusual, doesn't it? A pyramid without a capstone, an eye and a triangle. Today, the Illuminati appears to be controlled by the richest families in the world. Rothschild, Rockefeller, Warburg, Ford, Morgan, Schroeder, Baring, Himbrose, Bosch, and the Dutch royal family. These people own the world's banking systems. They control most of the world industries. Example, Bayer Aspen, Ford Motor Company, General Electric, General Motors, ICI, IBM, Kmart, Shell. At the bottom you see the words, the Great Seal, but this is not the seal of the United States. The Latin words above the seal mean
a new world order.
At the bottom of the pyramid you see the Roman numerals for 1776. This, of course, is the year of American independence. But is it a coincidence that it is also the year that Adam Weishaupt established the Illuminati, 1776? Around the world, communists, socialists and trade unionists celebrate May 1st. People in witchcraft celebrate May 1st. Satan worshippers celebrate May 1st. The Illuminati was founded on May 1st. Coincidence, or is there some common bond linking these organizations? Tapes are available on this subject. How many people in the May Day marches know what they're really celebrating? Here is David Rockefeller, chairman of the board of the CFR. The enormous wealth of the Rockefeller family has been accumulated by the simple process of owning most of the banks, including the Federal Reserve Bank in America. They also own the Chase Manhattan Bank, which is banker to the United Nations, and they own a surprising percentage of shares in our Australian banks. They control a large part of the world's industries. But more importantly, they control education through their tax-free foundations. They finance the Curriculum Development Centre in Canberra, which supplies textbooks and programs to most Australian schools. On the right is a list of some of the media they control. They own most of the daily newspapers in America and two of the big TV networks, NBC and CBS. It would take pages to list all the newspapers, magazines, radio, TV and movie companies controlled by the Rockefellers. But the Rockefeller Empire is only a baby compared with the Rothschilds. Here is where the Rothschilds fit in, or should we say where everyone fits in with the Rothschilds. It was Lord Rothschild who said,
"Give me control of a nation's money, and I care not who makes its laws."
What that really means is,
let the nation's leaders play their political party games, but when it comes to money, they will do as I tell them.
Another front organisation of the Illuminati began in 1883, founded by Sidney Webb and George Bernard Shaw. This stained glass window is in the Webb's home in England. It depicts Sidney Webb and George Bernard Shaw on the right reshaping the world. These two men set out to achieve world control by subversion and infiltration into government and finance. Let's look at that coat of arms above the globe. FS, the Fabian Society. See the wolf in sheep's clothing? Obviously, these men were deliberately using falsehood and deceit to achieve their goal. The Fabian Society has a lot of influence and control in Australia. For example, most of the Labor Party chiefs are members of the Fabian Society. They're quite open about their plans to get rid of the states and socialise Australia. In 1901, the states created the federal government and gave it limited powers in certain fields such as trade and defence. But over the years, men seeking centralised power have abused the Constitution, so the central government now has power over the very states which formed it. Bob Hawke wants to abolish the states and introduce complete socialism. He is a member of the Fabian Society, but did you know Bob Hawke was on the Reserve Bank Board until 1981? Remember the meaning of Lord Rothschild's statement?
Let the nation's leaders play their political party games, but when it comes to money, they will do as I tell them.
The Reserve Bank Board tells Prime Ministers what to do. This is why, over the years, governments change, party labels change, but major policies do not. Most federal politicians and top public servants are members of either the Fabian Society or the Royal Institute of International Affairs, the Australian equivalent of the American CFR. The Bulletin, October 78.
David Rockefeller, chairman of the Chase Manhattan Bank, financier extraordinaire and member of the famous family, is to be Prime Minister Malcolm Fraser's personal guest in Canberra next month.
That was in November 78. In October 81, David Rockefeller came to Australia, this time with former KGB agent Henry Kissinger. Do you think that this team of bankers had anything to do with the mergers of the Australian banks? Remember Karl Marx's point five?
Get control of a nation's money system.
Whoever controls our money system will control our resources.
Incidentally, the ANZ and the Wales are two of the five most profitable banks in the top 150 in the world.
Western nations consistently give away millions of dollars in grants and subsidise exports to communist nations. This book, National Suicide, documents the food, military equipment and technology flowing into Russia for decades.
The Russian war machine fed on American wheat, Western credits and technology.
In 1981, Poland owed $80 billion to private American banks. The banks appealed to the federal government for assistance because Poland was bankrupt. Naturally, the federal government paid the bill, and now American taxpayers are forced to pay a further $80 billion plus interest. It is well documented in government statistics and other publications that since 1917, communism has survived only because of massive support from Western governments using taxpayers' money. Now, the big question is why? Why would rich men and some Western politicians support a system of communism or socialism which would appear to be the path to their own destruction? The real issue is not capitalism versus communism as they would have us believe. It is government-protected capitalism which finances communism. The purpose is to eliminate free enterprise. After a man has far more money than he can possibly spend on pleasure, what is left to excite him? For those with the ruling class mentality, the answer is power, raw power over other human beings. Money can buy such power, but only to a point. After that, the name of the game is politics, and world politics is the ultimate game. These men are not truly capitalists in the classical sense of the word. They are rich socialists. They have gained their vast wealth by the gigantic fraud of the money system and monopolies. Monopolies can only exist with government protection to restrict and eliminate competition. Money alone does not motivate them. Many of them sincerely believe that a one-world government is for mankind's benefit, but they have the expectation that from behind the scenes, they will be the ones to rule. Big government is the conspiracy's life force. They want everyone working for the government or dependent on the government. But how do you sell big government to a people like us? In revolutionary terms, the tactic is known as pressure from above and pressure from below. Deliberately create problems, especially economic problems, and then offer solutions which will result in greater government control. If those who seek world control can organise mob violence, strikes, shortages, and also provide extensive news coverage, we will all throw our hands in the air and say, why doesn't the government do something? And what always follows? Yes, increased government power through new laws, supposedly to cope with the problem. Over the years, we have given huge grants to communist nations and equipped them with weapons and technology, so we have the constant threat of war. This is the meaning of pressure from above and pressure from below. Nationwide problems of unemployment, union unrest, and inflation are deliberately engineered so that we will demand more government control of the economy. The global threat of World War III is used to pressure us into accepting a one-world government as our only solution. The United Nations, one-world police force, one-world army, one-world church, one-world government. Conspiracies have deceived many people so well that they even laugh at the idea of any conspiracy. Some people would never admit to having been deceived, but there are conspiracies which have been cleverly programming the world for decades. We are told that world inflation is a serious problem. All the nations are deeply in debt. We are told that the world is running out of food, resources, and fossil fuels. And yet, millions of fertile acres in many countries are not being used for food production. People are forced to leave their farms and crowd into cities to earn a living. The world is not overpopulated, just the cities. In 1967, solutions to world problems were suggested by an organization called the Club of Rome. We are led to believe that this group of bankers, economists, ecologists, and humanists is a collection of rather harmless fanatics. In 1972, they published a book, The Limits to Growth, Doomsday Predictions for Earth. They claim that every possible step must be taken to save mankind. Why is it called the Club of Rome? Is it because it's led by Italians or Catholics? No, it's not very keen on churches at all. The club was formed on a private estate outside Rome. The estate is owned by David Rockefeller. At the top, you see that David Rockefeller is chairman of the board of the CFR. On the lower right is Carol Wilson, one of the directors. Carol Wilson is also on the executive committee of the Club of Rome, so the CFR links the Illuminati directly to the Club of Rome. This report was not easy to obtain. It is an outline of their ideas on how they think the world should be run. They have used mighty computers to analyze the world's problems from every conceivable angle, and they have come up with a computer solution to save us all. Here is one way the state planners gather information. A special library in Brisbane stores information from a Landsat satellite. They photograph geographic features, mineral reserves, towns and buildings. Very useful for map making. But today,
officials at NASA and the Kremlin are getting a lovely little album together with snapshots of Australians going about their business. This latest threat to our privacy comes in the form of advanced satellites carrying powerful cameras which can focus on a golf ball while 160 kilometres above the Earth's surface.
Later on, we'll see just how far computer technology has progressed and how all this information about each of us is to be used. Here is Dr. Aurelio Pace, head of the Club of Rome. He says, we must take a global approach. A new international order must be established, not only in the economic sphere, but also in social and political areas. At a meeting in Melbourne, Dr. Pace was asked,
how many countries does your group advise?
He snapped back the reply,
many. Next question.
Dr. Pace, you advocate a new world order. How do you intend to get the power or authority?
Dr. Pace paused for a moment and said,
we're going to use shock therapy to get the people to accept it. I'm sorry, but you'll have to give up democracy if the planet is to survive.
The solution, in his eyes, is one of a benevolent dictatorship. Dr. Pace declined to explain shock therapy. In this book, Mankind at the Turning Point, the Club of Rome makes no bones about their intention. They plan to reorganize the whole world system, right down to maximum and minimum wages, where you live, what work you do, the size of your family, and everything else they think is for your own good. Here are some more of their books. Rio, that is Reshaping the International Order, is their textbook on how they intend to run the world. They put forward some very convincing arguments. They believe that they, the academics, the enlightened ones, must look after mankind. Many people in the Club of Rome and its front organisations are sincere. They really believe that they know what is best for the masses. We live in the greatest productive era that mankind has ever known. Australia could almost feed the world by itself if the farmers were allowed to produce without government interference. Production is not the problem. Telegraph, September 78.
More than 500,000 laying hens are to be killed to force up the price of eggs. The mass slaughter has been ordered by the New South Wales Egg Board as part of a scheme to reduce production.
The Egg Board, the Wheat Board, the Fish Board and so on are designed to restrict free enterprise and eliminate competition. This is point 7 of Karl Marx's plan to bring a country under socialism. This book, I Want the Earth Plus 5%, explains how and why power is exercised over everyone through the money system. There is nothing wrong with money itself. It is a present mathematically impossible system which gives power. You've heard the saying,
power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely.
There is no man in this audience, in this country or on this earth who could be trusted as a world ruler. Even when they use computers, human beings make mistakes. no matter how sincere their intentions may be. I wouldn't trust this man, I wouldn't trust you, I wouldn't trust me with the kind of power that they will have. Nevertheless, through the Club of Rome, the Illuminati intends to establish a world rulership. They have divided the world into 10 regions. Region 4 includes Australia, New Zealand, Oceania, South Africa and Israel. Why Israel? Why does Bob Hawke make so many trips to Israel? The Club of Rome calls this their computer model. The 10 regions are practically in order now. Region 8 in Africa is to be a blacks-only area. When the white population has finally been removed from that region, the model will be complete. The system is designed to bring law and order. Law and order so that no one, and we mean no one, will be able to buck the system. Through the Club of Rome, the Illuminati is about to take over the world and run it their way. And people who don't understand what's happening and what is really behind it will hand the world over without second thought. Remember Dr. Pache said he was going to use shock therapy? In the next part, we'll investigate Dr. Pache's shock therapy and we'll see how it's already being applied. We're in the age of robots. They are not intelligent, that is, they cannot think by themselves, although they act as though they can. This 74 model is programmed to find its way through a maze. It locates and remembers obstacles and so navigates without bumping into them. When its batteries begin to run down, it plugs itself into a power point for a recharge. That was in 1974. Here is the 77 model. The article claims that this could be the housekeeper of the future. It is programmed by tape and performs various household duties. It serves dinner, vacuums rugs, and babysits. It has a 250-word vocabulary. It can even insult your enemies. Here is the 78 model. You may have seen these articles about it. Because it can be programmed, it could be made to do other things not limited to the domestic field. At Disneyland, there is a statue of Abraham Lincoln. This statue does some remarkable things considering it was built over 20 years ago. The eyes and hands move, the face muscles flex, and he appears to speak. It's done by the clever use of mechanical levers, hydraulic pumps, and small electric motors to make the parts move. It's so realistic, you'd think it was alive. Here is C-3PO from Star Wars. Of course, it was a man in a robot suit. But with today's super technology, can you imagine a robot full of tiny computers controlled by a larger computer, perhaps miles away? Seeing what's available to the public and technicians, what do you imagine is going on behind the scenes? Some people in the near future may not be quite what you think. Here is Photography Magazine of December 76 with an article about the making of a movie called Future World. On the far left, you see an all-white photo of Peter Fonda. He was painted with a special white paint and this photograph was taken. All the others are computer-generated images of various angles that never existed. Here are more of the computerized images that were used in that movie. Here is a digitizing disk. Those magnetic rings on the photo are sending coded information into the computer's memory banks. This is the console of that computer. At the top right is the image being generated. This computer is an IBM machine at NASA. Here is a close-up of one of the images we saw earlier. Once you have the basic information in the computer, you can alter it any way you want, and with a series of images, you can give him any facial expression and make him do anything by computer. Another close-up of the computer-generated face. How easy it would be to store information on people. Suppose a world leader died or disappeared, and it was to be kept from the public. A computer programmed to simulate his features, movements, mannerisms, even his voice patterns, could show him making a speech to the world, but you would be watching a computer-generated image of a man who no longer existed. This is a photograph of Pine Gap just south of Alice Springs. Many things about Pine Gap are mysteries and will probably remain so for a long time. The deepest hole ever dug in Australia is recorded as being 28,000 feet. That's over 5 miles at Pine Gap. You can see on the far left what looks like a flagpole, but flagpoles aren't usually 200 feet tall, even on an American base. If this was the tip of a 5 mile antenna going down into that hole, it would be ideal for transmitting or receiving energy at high voltage and at low frequency. Nikola Tesla, scientific genius, yet few people have heard of him. His work at the turn of the century gave us our modern electricity supply system, electric motors, and much of our modern technology. He demonstrated that enormous power could be drawn from the electrical potential between the Earth's surface and our ionosphere. After his death in 1943, the US government seized all his private papers and equipment. If we are correct, Pine Gap is using Nikola Tesla's secrets. It seems likely that Pine Gap is a power source for several thousand miles to ships, submarines and aircraft that have circuits tuned to Pine Gap's broadcast. Did you know that a rather simple circuit can be used to recharge 12-volt batteries by drawing on the power from a local radio station? If you raise the voltage 100,000 times or millions of times and you broadcast power at low frequencies, you can receive it from much greater distances and charge up much bigger batteries, perhaps even plasma batteries. Pine Gap is about 12 miles south of Alice Springs. The security is so tight that Gough Whitlam was denied entry even when he was Prime Minister. It is known that the security systems use the very latest in voice response computers. Every person has his own unique voice print, rather like a fingerprint. In only a few seconds, a voice response computer can identify you by your voice. Imagine the possibilities. How many telephone conversations are being recorded and stored in computers right now? But the centre at Pine Gap can't hold a candle to the massive computer complex down near Woomera in South Australia, which is linked to the great computer tie-up around the world. There are now at least 160 giant computers linked constantly by satellite. The uses of these will perhaps be a bit more obvious later on. Nation Review 74.
Pine Gap does science fiction research. The Pine Gap Research Facility near Alice Springs has managed to keep secret until now one of the most unbelievable research projects in the world. The United States has been carrying out continuous research into electromagnetic propulsion at Pine Gap since it was established in 1966. Research into electromagnetic propulsion began in the United States soon after World War II. After some successful results, it became necessary to move the experimentation from populated areas to more remote spots.
Pine Gap expands, September 69, four domes. Pine Gap in 1975, five domes. 1978, six domes. The antenna faces a different direction. The operations there are top secret, but we do know that they are broadcasting enormous amounts of power at high voltage and low frequency. Why is this power being broadcast, and who is receiving it? We'll see that Pine Gap may be part of a worldwide network with a rather special purpose. The subject of UFOs always raises questions, doubts, arguments and tempers. UFOs seem to be real and obviously people have seen something. This is from the movie in the mid-50s called The Forbidden Planet. The two-tube energy exchange system under the craft indicates that electric flying machines were well tried and tested, possibly as early as World War II. In the top drawing, an aircraft wing uses pressure differences to create lift. Below, the saucer is a circular version of the same wing shape. So how do we cause air to flow from the top to the outside edges to produce lift? In 1821, Faraday showed how a magnet moving in a coil produces electricity. The Earth has a magnetic field. If we could build something to work on the same principle, but spinning millions of times faster, we could create very high voltages. If electric charges were made to flow from the top of the saucer and around to the underside of the craft, the air would be compressed underneath. And this would generate a pressure increase below, causing the craft to lift with little or no turbulence. Theoretically, the craft should work, but it would be difficult to control. If we vary the flow to three different points under the craft, we can control direction. The charge moving over the surface would generate a glow. Reports of UFOs have mentioned glowing. Since World War II, at least, the United States and other countries have known the secrets of electric flying machines. At the bottom, you see an earlier model. Those portholes are really exhaust outlets for a combustion engine that generated the 15 million volts needed to drive the craft. At that time, they had to generate a very hot conductive gas and flow it through a magnetic field. Today, there are much better ways. The secret is in the plasmoid in the center, shown red. It's a type of plasma battery. It's a conductive gas spinning at incredibly high speed in a vacuum. It produces an electric charge which is directed up the tube to the field focus ball, and from there it flows all over the non-conductive outside surface. The extendable landing pods, shown yellow, are to conduct various amounts of charge. This gives stability and allows turning. There is a book explaining how these sources work. The question is, who's making them and why? These craft need a power source of high voltage and low frequency. There are numerous sightings of UFOs in Central Australia. Do you think there might be some connection with Pine Gap? Periodically, we get convincing reports from the outback about people seeing UFOs. This one is from Sunday Sun, January 78.
Post Magazine, February 78. The UFO Show.
Also in the outback of Australia.
Sunday Sun, November 78. UFOs are terrorising the outback.
Do you remember in January 79 the UFO sighting in New Zealand? There was a sighting a couple of hours later in Southport, then in Toowoomba, then in Dalby. I wonder where they were heading. UFO sightings are continually being reported, a surprising number from Central Australia. This book, The Mendeloff Conspiracy, will not be easy to obtain. It was written in 1972 and shortly afterwards removed from the market. The author, Martin Caden, has several other bestsellers, so why was this one stopped? It is supposedly fiction about a plot by scientists who reason that the world has come so close to nuclear destruction that they, the scientists, must take action to fool the people of the world into a harmony to get rid of the weapons of war and set up a one-world government. The names in the book are thinly disguised real scientists. This is written on the back of the book.
Could it be that the government was really endorsing a grotesque, misguided experiment intended to shock the world into nuclear submission?
In the story, they used a false invasion from space to fool the people of the world into a one-world government. Star Trek. Star Trek was written and produced primarily by Gene Roddenberry, who was advised by the RAND Corporation, RAND, R-A-N-D, for research and development for the US Air Force. Why would RAND be so interested in the details and production of this particular show? The RAND company told Roddenberry,
"This is what you will use in the show, a spacecraft that can travel faster than light."
The Enterprise may be a bit ambitious for us to build just yet. It would need to be 2.5 miles long, but we do have the understanding of technology to travel at speeds faster than light. Just before his death, Albert Einstein admitted there was an error in some of his work. The error was discovered in the early 50s, and since then tremendous advances have been made in the field of super technology and super physics. For example, those so-called laser guns or photon cannons are quite real. Such cannons have already been tested from US and Australian warships. They completely annihilate the target at the speed of light. Some years ago, they were able to destroy an aeroplane 5 miles up in seconds, leaving no debris. When President Carter announced in late 1977 that the death ray was a big joke, he was either poorly informed or else he was deliberately covering up. Carter was trained by the US Navy. He is a qualified nuclear engineer and would be well aware of projects underway for years on plasma ray systems. Anyone can get information on these things from the Smithsonian Science Information Exchange, also at some universities. Here is a page about explosion fields and plasma flows. Information is available to those who want to research these things. In August 78, the Australian reported that the death ray was real and that $450 million had been spent on research. They can kill a high subsonic target in flight by a laser gun. This supposedly latest news was years out of date. This is from a Star Trek magazine. The author says,
"The awesome, powerful starship Enterprise roamed the galaxies, a benevolent force amid the sometimes chaotic and sometimes evil worlds it found. Star Trek today is no longer just a television series. It has become a philosophy for many who look on it as portraying a society that has overcome most of the problems that plague us today. A society which they hope will come to pass in the not too distant future."
What would happen if someone else's starship arrived with this message?
"People of Earth, we come in peace. We mean you no harm. We can solve your problems for you. Join the Federation. We offer you the blessings of our advanced technology so everyone can live in peace, love and harmony."
Would you believe that they were from outer space and their offer was genuine? The human mind is like a computer. No matter how intelligent you may be, the reliability of your mind can only be as great as the information fed into it. If it is possible to program the input of your mind, it is entirely possible to program what you will think. And yes, it's even possible to program you to laugh at the idea that you're being programmed. Public opinion is swayed to and fro by newspapers, radio and TV. We are often given emotional issues and opinions rather than facts. So we only get part of the story. A wise man once said,
"Your judgment is no better than your information."
If someone wants to program public opinion, all he needs to do is control the media. If he wanted to control the world, he would have to get people to want a one-world government because they believed it was the only solution. But a solution to what? Give people a choice between world chaos and world government. But where would he start? First of all, convince everyone that the whole world is in big trouble. We have riots, race problems around the world, black versus white, Arabs and Jews, police and radicals. Have you noticed they always get a good news coverage and TV cameras just happen to be ready for protest marches and riots? Have you listened to the chanting? Regardless of what the protest is about, most marches sound something like this. What do we want?
We want this.
What do we want?
We want that.
What do we want?
We want this.
Have you noticed the same organisers in the background? Most people live in polluted cities where they are led to believe that the whole world is overcrowded. But it's not overcrowded in the country, is it? We are threatened by the so-called atomic arms race. We are living on the brink of World War III. The whole world could be destroyed, they tell us. Now, what would unite all nations? If the Americans offered peace, the Chinese wouldn't accept it. If the Chinese offered peace, the Russians wouldn't accept it. What if some advanced race from outer space made the offer? Wouldn't most people accept it out of fear? Will you be really surprised when they do arrive? Of course not. You've been programmed for years to expect them. In the mid-50s, the Forbidden Planet, with its highly advanced technology as an incentive to mankind. Does this spaceship look familiar? You saw it in that movie. In the late 60s, we had 2001. Do you remember that incredible IBM computer named HAL? Here is HAL. H-A-L stands for Heuristically Programmed Algorithmic Computer. But move each of these three letters, H-A-L, forward one place in the alphabet, and H-A-L becomes IBM. HAL, or is it IBM, ran this entire spaceship and the men on board, but that movie took us a step further. If man reached the next stage of his so-called evolution, he would be born into the new age and become a brother of the universe. And then we had Star Wars, and we were introduced to the Force, the cosmic consciousness. This is continued in The Empire Strikes Back and follow-up movies. It is witchcraft and occult teaching from old Illuminati books. Newsweek, December 77. Was this merely to introduce Close Encounters, or are we to believe that the UFOs are really coming? Close Encounters of the Third Kind, contact with extraterrestrials. Are we to believe that the super advanced beings will be the solution to all of man's problems? Do you really believe God needs a flying saucer to visit us? The Australian, January 79, asked the question,
"Close Encounters, are we alone? Probably not,"
says John Pinkney, who writes regular articles on the occult. He believes that we will soon be visited by advanced civilizations.
"Perhaps they are preparing to help us. Our elder brothers are coming,"
says the Courier Mail, January 79. So, the news media is telling us, the movies are telling us, there are also other ways to get us to look for our so-called brothers from space.
How audiences are fingertip controlled.
Controlling people through music is a specialised science. People can be indoctrinated not only by words but also by music. The careful use of flashing lights, pulses, beats, tempos, electronic sound effects, ultra-high and low frequencies can be used to have a subliminal programming effect on a person without him being aware. MASH. The theme music is called Suicide is Painless. This double LP was advertised in the Australian, November 79.
Better than drugs. Music from the drug culture. Perpetrated for the proliferation of evil. The song that made people kill themselves.
Gloomy Sunday has been blamed for so many suicides that most radio stations refuse to play it.
Planetary ultra-atmosphere. occupants of interplanetary most extraordinary craft. Have you listened closely to the words of this song? They tell us to call on the super intelligent beings from space to come and help mankind. Our Earth may never survive. What do they say here?
We are your friends.
On the record label, it says that this song is
a recognized anthem of World Contact Day.
I wonder what that means. An excellent tape is available on programming people by the use of different kinds of music. On November 26, 77, thousands of Britons were contentedly watching their Saturday night television shows when bleeps interrupted the normal program. The voice of Astron had a message for the planet Earth.
This is the voice of Astron. I am an authorized representative of the intergalactic mission, and I have a message for the planet Earth. We are beginning to enter the period of Aquarius, and there are many corrections which have to be made by Earth people. All your weapons of evil must be destroyed. You only have a short time to live together in peace.
Remember Dr. Pache said he was going to use shock therapy to get us all to accept the one world control? It's quite easy to set up a powerful transmitter to overpower radio and TV stations. Was that a practice run? The plan at this stage appears to be a worldwide economic collapse to destroy people's faith in silver, gold and money. It may be done some way like this. The Australian, January 78, it was announced suddenly in India on the 11 o'clock late night news that large banknotes were declared worthless. The next day people realised the true value of banknotes. They were bits of worthless paper. Was this merely a trap for Mrs. Gandhi and her friends who supposedly stockpile large notes, or was it a trial run for the worldwide collapse? In July 78, a newspaper reporter was asked how the communists established control over the economy in Vietnam. He said,
"The North Vietnamese froze all bank accounts, then suddenly changed the currency on the basis of one new piastre to 500 old piastre."
That means every $5 was now worth 1 cent.
However, people were able to receive only 200 new piastre, and the rest was confiscated. The effect was to destroy the savings of the entire population and make them dependent on the regime.
That report was from News Weekly, a small independent newspaper. The reporter gives a good description of life inside Vietnam today. In case you're wondering what happened to mortgages and debts, they were cancelled. That's right, no more debts to pay off. But people no longer own their homes and property either. Everything is under central government control. The international bankers control the money system of all nations, both Western and communist. Did you know that Rockefeller's Chase Manhattan Bank has a branch in Peking? Also, number one Karl Marx place in Moscow? They have already planned a new money system for Australia. In part four, you'll find out how it works. Who determines the price of gold and silver? Make sure you see part four of this program before you invest in silver and gold. The Middle East, the most hotly contested piece of real estate on Earth. Suppose the international bankers engineered an overnight worldwide financial collapse and a couple of low-yield nuclear bombs were dropped there. People everywhere would panic, thinking that World War III had started. Wouldn't it be convenient for Dr. Pache and his Illuminati friends if, just in time, the electric flying saucers suddenly appeared around the world and over radio and TV, we all heard this message?
People of Earth, we come in peace. Let us help you. If you allow us to reorganize your planet, we will give you the blessings of our technology. All mankind can live in peace, love and harmony. If not, we will back off and let you destroy yourselves. The choice is yours.
This would be the ultimate in shock therapy, wouldn't it? If it happens, will you believe it's from outer space or a hidden civilization from the past? If you think the idea is far-fetched, we'll show you in a few moments some of the preparations now underway. We live in the age of computers. Science promises that the golden age is just around the corner. The computers will do everything for us and life will be peace, love and harmony. This is an old photograph of the filing room in the US Social Security Department. Those reels are computer tapes and this room holds files of personal private information on every person in America. Governments around the world have been gathering information on you and me and feeding it into computers. Why do they need so much information? How good is the record-keeping system? To show how far we've come in the field of super-speed technology, here is a quote from February 76 edition of Computer Digest.
In the half second it takes for spilled coffee to fall from table to floor, today's computer can debit 2,000 checks to 300 different bank accounts and examine electrocardiograms of 1,000 patients and score 150,000 answers on 3,000 exams, concurrently evaluating the effectiveness of the question, and figure the payroll for a company with 1,000 employees and still have time left before the coffee hits the floor. The laser computer possesses the capability of placing on one reel of magnetic tape less than 5,000 feet long the names, addresses, credit rating and 20 pages of personal information of every man, woman and child in the United States. That is 220 million people, each with 20-page manuscript about himself packed onto one reel of recording tape.
That was in February 76. September 78, that microchip on the girl's finger contains 48,000 transistors. A memory chip this size can store 8 times as much information as a Sydney telephone directory. This chip goes even further. It can recognise human voices. It's a voice response computer. Computers have many uses. Let's look at one rather special application.
Sunday Mail, June 77, the day you'll get rid of your money.
It seems that the credit card system will soon replace notes and coins. Does your wallet look like this? There are several credit card systems operating now. Some people think they are the answer, others won't touch them. A few believe that we should have one card for all transactions. And in Australia, one likely contender is bank card. This is from their advertising brochure. The ideas they promote are naturally the positive ones. It reduces paperwork in shops and banks, no notes or coins to print. It reduces the crime of theft, easy to carry, no bad checks. It certainly seems highly logical. There are some people who cannot control themselves when it comes to money and spending. Are you one? Or are you living carefully within your means? You don't have any debts, do you?
Sunday Telegraph, January 78. Cash is dirty money and cheques are a write-off.
Summing up the article, very soon no one will use cash. We'll all use a debit credit card. In many places you cannot pay cash for anything. The shops will not accept it. You must use a credit card. It sounds incredible, but they will not accept cash. It seems that someone is very anxious to get us all onto bank card. This is a confidential letter that was sent to managers only of one of the banking groups. The managers are told that there are to be no more personal loans or overdrafts to professional men, that is, dentists, optometrists, opticians and so on. These people must go onto bank card. The letter tells the managers to investigate their accounts and send the information to bank card headquarters. They'll do the rest.
Sydney Sun Herald, February 79. Bank card, at last the banks strike it rich. Bank card has become a bonanza, not for the customer of course, but for the backers of the green and yellow credit card, the big Australian banks. Bank card was launched in October 74. There are now around 2 million cardholders in Australia.
That was in February 79. Through bank card, Australians are now spending over $30 million a week on personal goods.
This is wonderful business for the banks that own bank card, because these purchases often lead the cardholders into debt.
In the early days, the banks were frustrated by Australians paying their bills each month, but...
No longer. According to the Reserve Bank, Australians owed $655 million to bank card last December, 78. It's estimated that the banks were earning interest at the rate of around $6 million a month out of bank card. Not bad going for a relatively new organisation with an $8 million investment.
Now do you understand how the banks create money out of nothing? How is it possible to be owed $655 million when they had only $8 million to start with? A profit of $6 million a month on an $8 million investment worked out to be 900% profit a year. No wonder they're promoting bank card. For those who think they are getting something for nothing by using bank card and then paying the account before the end of the month, don't forget, the storekeeper has to pay 5% or so for every time you use your card. To cover this, he's forced to raise prices. Incidentally, that $655 million debt in 1978 had risen to $1.19 billion in June 1981. Brisbane people will recognise this telecom building at Woolloongabba. Modern electronic telephone equipment requires little space and staff, so why such a large building? Every part of this building is electronically monitored. Even employees with ID cards are prohibited from certain areas. This building is also for the Central Bank Card Computer for Queensland. It feeds into the giant computer complex near Woomera in South Australia. Bank Card has two purposes. One is to condition you to the cashless society. The second is to gather information on you. All Australian bank cards begin with the number 4. This is not just for Queensland, it's for every Australian state. You may remember, Australia is part of Region 4 in the Club of Rome's 10 regions.
Sunday Sun, May 78. Checkouts go computer.
Apparently this system helps shopkeepers balance their stocks.
And in the same paper, this new cash register has magic eyes.
You may have seen a special marking appearing on many items. It tells the computer all about the item you buy. This special mark is already on a number of magazines, food lines and other items. Let's take a closer look. The magic eye of the cash register, or should we say checkout register, can recognise the thickness and spacing of those lines and it knows all about the item you buy. Now what do you think the next step will be? When they suddenly declare that cash is worthless, like they did in India and Vietnam, you'll be forced to get your bank card. So when you buy something, the computer will know all about you and what you buy. Nothing will be private. What will happen when you're short of credit? You try to buy something, you put your card under the scanner, and within a few seconds, the checkout computer, which is linked to the central computer, will flash a red light.
Sorry, no credit.
What will you do? What will you do? It wouldn't help to start abusing the storekeeper. It's not his fault. The only option left would be to steal someone else's card. This is already happening. People are losing their cards and they are being stolen. Here is a warning bulletin from Bank Card Headquarters. This is part of a list of bank cards throughout Australia which have been lost, stolen or have bad credit ratings. Notice the red numbers at the top of each column. They all begin with 4. But how are they going to stop people from using stolen cards? Remember the old tactic of pressure from above and pressure from below?
Somebody stole my card and spent all my money before I found out. I can't get credit anywhere. The family's starving.
Why doesn't the government do something? How will you react when they introduce the new law, which says everyone has to be numbered? The laser machinery is already waiting to tattoo a number onto your right hand or onto your forehead. Most people are right-handed, and the number on the forehead is for people who wear gloves in cold countries where the hands are normally covered. Obviously, you can't steal hands or heads, so under the new system, there could be no forgery. So the problem of stolen bank cards will be solved. But now, every transaction that you make will be recorded in the computer system. This is the computer link-up system from the Club of Rome's book, Mankind at the Turning Point. They have worked out your diet, calorie allowance, work hours, food distribution, entertainment, size of families, and on and on. You will be paid in what they call energy units, credited to your account in the computer. This will be the new money system. Gold, silver, cash, checks will be obsolete. In scientific journals lately, IBM have been boasting to the world that the giant computer complex near Woomera is the ultimate in computer technology. It is by far the most advanced in the worldwide network of at least 160 computers linked by satellite. Imagine just how much information could be stored in a network like that. But what if you don't want to be in this system? Will you accept a number and be told where to live, what work to do, what you may eat, your entertainment, how many children you may have? In the book of Revelation, there is an interesting section in chapter 13. It refers to a dictator who will one day take control of the world.
He compels all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked with an inscription stamped on their right hands or on their forehead, so that no one will have power to buy or sell unless he bears the stamp, that is, the name of the beast or the number of his name. Let anyone who has intelligence calculate the number of the beast, for it is a human number, the number of a certain man. His number is 666.
The worldwide computer network now recognises the code numbers of things you buy. It would be easy for it to also recognise your code number. Now what about the 666? Have you studied the bank card symbol? Can you see a yellow 6 on an orange 6 on a red 6? It certainly looks like three sixes, doesn't it?
Finance and government institutions in the US and abroad are utilising variations of this horizontal logo, 666.
Does this also look like three sixes? This symbol is used by the European Common Market. In the past, various religious groups used convincing arguments to identify the beast of Revelation. Julius Caesar was supposed to be the beast, so was Napoleon Bonaparte and Adolf Hitler. Numerology has even been used to make the Latin words on the Pope's hat add up to 666. But none of these would be able to totally control what every human being buys and sells. What we are being offered is no less than a world dictatorship in which money, as we know it, will be obsolete. The only money will be energy units in a computer account. To earn energy units, you must work where the computer tells you. To have an account in the computer, you must be numbered. Is it a coincidence that 1900 years ago, the Apostle John wrote the Bible prophecy that no one would be able to get a job or buy anything without a certain mark tattooed on their right hand or forehead? In 1978, the Chinese completed construction of a superhighway right through to Israel. A huge dam has also been constructed in northeast Syria on the Euphrates River. Two more dams are on the Euphrates, one in Turkey and one in Iraq. They could be used to dry up the river for the kings of the east to cross for their invasion, as mentioned in prophecy, Revelation 16:12. According to Revelation, the world dictator will bring in such fantastic plans for economic prosperity that the whole world will acclaim him. He will permit the Jews to rebuild the temple, and they will think he's marvellous, but he will turn against them shortly afterwards. The world dictator will set himself up and rule the world from the temple. He will demand that he be worshipped as God. Anyone who refuses to worship him will be executed by the guillotine. Revelation 13:15. In recent years, there has been a tremendous growth in unusual religions and philosophies. Many are from what is known as the Great White Brotherhood. It can be traced back to ancient satanic religions. One of their books on the left is Links with Space. It's telling us that the so-called New Age is about to begin. They believe that our elder brothers will soon come and teach us the secrets of the universe. Fred Robertson, founder of a community in Western Australia known as the Universal Brotherhood, says,
"There's a new age of peace and prosperity ahead for the world. The message comes from our space brothers who say it's about to dawn. That's the good news, but before, there will be cataclysmic changes. We are preparing here for the millennium, a new age of peace and prosperity for the world. Our space brothers have revealed that first there will be cataclysmic changes to the planet."
Mary, his wife, adds,
"Some people may be lifted up by beams of light into flying saucers to be kept safe till after the cataclysm."
Fred continues,
"Knowledge was passed on to me by two teachers who trained me in Queensland many years ago. Both were from other more advanced planets, but had been incarnated on Earth in human form. Among other things, they told me the timetable for Earth's transition into the new age."
None of this is new. It's been in occult and astrology books for centuries. This book, Satan is Alive and Well on Planet Earth, will help you understand the origins of false religions, reincarnation, astrology, and what they call the new age. You've seen the connection between history, politics, money, religion, and technology. Well, Jesus said,
"As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of my second coming."
What did he mean by that? As well as the evil that existed then before the flood and certainly exists today, there are other signs for us to look for.
"The light of the moon will be as the light of the sun, and the light of the sun will be sevenfold as the light of 7 days concentrated into one."
Isaiah 30:26.
"There was a great earthquake. The moon became like blood."
Revelation 6:12.
"A third of the sun was smitten and a third of the moon."
Revelation 8:12. So let's see if these prophecies are possible.
"The moon became like blood."
If the sun's light to earth was reduced by one third, the light from the moon would also be reduced by a third. This is how things may look if the sun is disturbed sufficiently. Great storms are predicted. Again, science and the Bible are in agreement.
"And great hailstones, between 50 and 60 pounds, fell from the sky."
Revelation 16:21. 50-pound hailstones? What we know as hailstones are really particles of ice. What if it should really hail stones? Where could the stones come from? The Earth regularly passes through streams of cometary debris, producing a spate of so-called falling stars. Most falling stars are no larger than a grain of sand. They ignite and burn up in the air. If they hit us, they may not completely burn up, but could strike the Earth and really hail stones. Not far from us, in solar terms, there is a belt of asteroids between Jupiter and Mars. These asteroids are rocks ranging from a few pounds in weight to several miles in diameter. If these were disturbed during the alignments and attracted towards the sun, the Earth could be showered with rocks and boulders. This is a comet photographed in Western Australia a few years ago, but can you imagine a large meteor, perhaps a mile in diameter, crashing onto the moon? We are told that the craters on the moon happen like this. If something like this happened here, it would shake the whole world. But of course that couldn't happen. The atmosphere would protect us, wouldn't it? Or would it? This great hole is the Arizona crater, almost a mile in diameter. It's a big hole. Whatever caused this must have shaken the whole world. But the certainties that we can rely on today are before us. The Bible is the inspired word of God, and its prophecies of those coming events are falling across our path with greater frequency. Science is foretelling the same events. This is not intended to be a Bible study. The purpose is to provide basic information on historical events and scientific knowledge, much of which has been withheld or deliberately distorted. Bible prophecy has always been 100% accurate. It has much to say about coming events. Today we see many denominations and religious groups using the same Bible translations, and yet they have conflicting interpretations. Obviously, they can't all be right. Because of the military conquest by Alexander the Great around 300 BC, a language developed so scientifically accurate that any spoken or written message could have only one possible interpretation. This language, Koine Greek, not classical Greek, but Koine Greek, K-O-I-N-E, became the original language of the New Testament. There is great benefit in learning Bible truths under a minister who continues to study and teach directly from the original. Bible prophecy describes the Great Tribulation. It begins with the emergence of a popular leader who quickly brings about a short time of world peace, but it will be followed by unparalleled natural disasters. In Matthew 24:21, Christ said,
"There will be great tribulation, such as has not been from the beginning of the world until now, and never will be again."
A global war will start, great weapons. A quarter of the world's population will die from war and hunger. There will be earthquakes, mountains and islands will be dislodged, the sun will be darker. Panic and terror will be everywhere. A third of all shipping will be destroyed. Many people will die from poisoned waters. Another third of the world will die from war and plagues. More earthquakes and great hailstones. All life in the sea will die. The sun turns fierce and scorches humanity. The greatest earthquake in history. Giant hailstones. They may occur very soon, or they could be years away. The world leader will move into the temple in Jerusalem. He will be the world dictator, commonly known as the beast or antichrist of Revelation. He declares that everyone must be numbered on the right hand or forehead. The 200 million soldiers from the east head towards Israel for the battle of all time involving all nations, the Battle of Armageddon. This is when Christ returns in glory just in time to prevent complete annihilation of the world. He will then wipe out all those people who have refused to accept him as the Messiah. Bible prophecy was not given to create panic and fear. The Bible is God's handbook, given to let you know what will happen so that you can be ready. Jesus told us in Matthew 24 that no one can know the day nor the hour of his return.
"For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a loud cry of summons, with the shout of an archangel, and with the blast of the trumpet of God. And those who have departed this life in Christ will rise first. Then we, the still living who remain on the earth, shall simultaneously be caught up along with the resurrected dead in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so always we shall be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort and encourage one another with these words."
In recent years, many denominations are using welfare programs and emotionalism to draw crowds and raise money. Many church leaders do not believe even basic Bible truths. It looks as though the prophesied one world church is on the way. You may be living a good life or otherwise. You may have religion or a philosophy. At any moment, your death could occur. Man was made to enjoy a close relationship with the Creator, but man chose to go his own way. This act of rebellion or passive indifference is what the Bible describes as sin.
"All have sinned and come short of the glory of God."
Romans 3:23.
"The wages of sin is death."
Romans 6:23. Good works, religion, morality, none of these will bridge the gap. Man cannot reach God by his own efforts.
"It is by free grace, God's unmerited favour, that you are saved from judgment through your faith. And this salvation is not of your own doing, it is the gift of God, not because of works, lest any man should boast."
Ephesians 2:8 and 9. On the cross, Jesus Christ paid in full for all the sins of every person, past, present and future.
"He is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance."
2 Peter 3:9. Repentance is a change of attitude or thinking. In Acts 16:31,
"Believe in and on the Lord Jesus Christ." That is, give yourself up to him. Take yourself out of your own keeping and entrust yourself into his keeping, and you will be saved.
In John 14:6, Jesus said,
"I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me."
Many have claimed to have been sent from God. Jesus Christ is unique. He proved his claims when he rose from the dead. John 3:36,
"He who believes on, relies on the Son, now possesses eternal life. But whoever is unbelieving, refuses to trust in, disregards the Son, will never experience life. But the wrath of God remains on him continually."
This makes it quite clear that people who reject Jesus Christ and depend on religion, living by the golden rule or any other rules, will suffer everlasting misery separated from God. If you have not already received God's free gift of eternal life, you can do so right now. You will not be asked to raise your hand or come to the front or embarrass anyone. In the privacy of your own mind, you can tell God the Father in your own words that you are believing and trusting in Christ right now. Bible prophecy reveals that during the tribulation, the One World Church will introduce public executions by the guillotine. The victims will be people who become believers or people who refuse to be numbered. Now, what will happen to people who are numbered?
Painful ulcers came on the people who were marked with the stamp of the beast and who did homage to his image.
Revelation 16:2. And then, for eternity,
the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest, day or night, those who pay homage to the beast and his image, and whoever receives the stamp of his name upon him.
Revelation 14:11. So there you have it. Do what you must to survive, but do not get numbered. But conspiracy is different. On the surface, it rests on two pillars, big government and money control. Exposure is their greatest fear. With the knowledge gained from this presentation and from books and tapes, learn to read between the lines of news reports.
Hong Kong Standard, September 80. Identity cards are must.
For residents and visitors. How long before they start putting numbers on people? Bank card, Visa and MasterCharge are part of the same worldwide computerized credit system. This giant computer network grows more powerful every day as information is fed into it by anyone who continues to use these cards. Throughout history, the great battle has been for the control of people's minds. We have briefly touched on many subjects, and as you learn more, you will realize that religious organizations and secret societies have used politics and finance as fronts for the great conspiracy which seeks to enslave mankind for eternity. Christ warned us in Matthew 24:23,
if anyone says to you, here is Christ, or there he is, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will arise, and they will show great signs and wonders, so as to deceive and lead astray, if possible, even the elect, God's chosen ones.
This warning is probably more important today than ever before. This advertisement would have us believe
the Christ is now here.
Major newspapers throughout the world printed this on April 24, 1982. One thing is for certain, this is not the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything in this advertisement contradicts the Bible description of Christ's return. Whatever the purpose behind recent events, the important issue now is, if you have not yet made a decision on God's free offer of eternal life, you are urged to do so above all else. Anything could happen from here on at any moment. It is suggested you find a church where Bible truths are correctly analysed and consistently taught. A free Bible study tape is available on request. You can only benefit from God's promises if you know what the promises are. This program is not a front for any religious organization or political party. It has been created and financed by a few people who spent countless hours in preparation. You can arrange for your friends to see it. No charge is made, but if you wish to support this work, donations or offers of help are appreciated.